This church this evening, let's all stand together. We're so glad you're here. We're going to start by singing song 612. He keeps me singing. Let's lift it up. There's within my heart a melody Jesus whispers sweet and low. Let's lift it up again and sing.
There's within my heart.
Seated, and we're excited about being in church tonight. Thank you for being here, and I tell you what, a beautiful day we've had coming in, and thankful to the Lord for what He has given us. We'll just give you a few prayer requests, and we're going to go right into prayer time, asking the Lord to bless a bunch of folks. Hopefully you got your prayer request sheet as you came in, and we'll go through that in just a moment, but I also want to tell you there's a sheet out in back on that black table in between the outside doors, and it's a sheet Brother Chuck Martin put together for work, but it goes through seven different areas to pray for our leadership of our nation and then our local leadership, but then other areas of our nation and our church, our family, they're praying for. There's sheets back there that we copied off. If you'd like to take one of those, it's just a good prayer guide to go by, and gives a lot of good information, and they're out there in preparation for the National Day of Prayer is tomorrow, and that's what it was in preparation for his work, and so that's a lot of work put into that. So if you want to make that a part of your prayer routine, then that would be a great blessing. But I also want you to be praying as we go through our sheet in just a moment. I want you to continue to pray, Brother David Harrison. He's over at Holston Valley, or he is out of Holston Valley. He was there. He's got home, and they've got him on some medication. They did a heart cath and didn't see any need to do anything for his heart. There's a little bit of a blockage on one spot, but they thought that would be all right. But he got him on new medication, and it's making him ill right now. So please keep Brother David Harrison lifted up in prayer. And then we're praying for the family of Cecil Ball. Cecil went home to be with the Lord. And that family, of course, praying for Brother Richard and Sheila and the whole family. That service will be this Saturday here at the church, and they'll have the visitation from 12:30 to 1. I'm going to make sure about that. 12:30 to 1, and then the service will be at 1 here in the auditorium. So we'll invite you to that if you'd like to come. Make sure here. Yes, 12:30 to 1, and then the funeral at 1 o'clock here, and then the burial will be at 2 down at Boone's Creek at the Washington County Memorial Garden. So please keep them lifted up in prayer. There's also visitation at Jeffers Funeral Home on Friday night before, and please pray for the Ball family. Also praying for the Snodgrass family, and that service for Billy Snodgrass will be here in the auditorium at 3 o'clock on Sunday afternoon with a visitation for an hour before that as well to greet the family. So those are some folks who want you to pray for. Continue to pray for Miss Edith Rourke as she continues through treatments, and praying for Bob Daniels as well, Miss Judy Whitson, and praying for Brother Mitch Perry, Brother Nathan's father-in-law, as he continues to rehab at home after that surgery, and then praying for Brother James McEwen as he had that surgery, got the test back, it was good, it wasn't cancerous, but we're still praying he recovers. after that procedure. So keep him lifted up in prayer. Brother Lynn Anderson taking treatments as well, and Brother Bill Magnus recovering. So keep him in prayer also. And then continue to pray. If you look on your left-hand side there of your sheet, Pam Norris and Timmy Acano, and those both hip surgeries, and then praying for Brother James McHugh. And as I mentioned, Stephen Gallion's doing well, had that knee surgery, but he's not here tonight, but he said he's doing good. I'm going to talk to him, so keep him lifted up in prayer. And then Pat Scalf, Miss Debbie Deacons, continue to pray for Leslie Farmer, and Judy Whitson, and Karen Cole, and Sharon Harmon, Sergio Maluzzi. Sergio's got a PET scan next Tuesday, so keep him in prayer if you would, Miss Sharon told me this evening. And then praying for Tracy Kirk, and Lynn Anderson, Edith Rourke, and Bob Daniels, and James Ketron, who has hospice in with him over at his house. So please keep that family and him lifted up in prayer. And then praying for Joel Johnson, and he would have had dialysis today, and Jan Saylor and Pat Shaw and the Gambles, keep them lifted up in prayer. Miss Sherry Edens, praying for Sheila Daniels also, and Jerry Marsha. Brother Jerry was here Sunday, but just keep him lifted up in prayer. A lot of health concerns going on. Robert and John Cassie. And then praying for Miss Tracy Carey. She's got some surgery coming up here in just a day or two. And then praying for Bob Smith as he's down in HC, as he continues to rehab and get stronger. So please keep him lifted up in prayer. He's anxious to get home. Any final date yet? Just still working, Ms. Karen? Okay. Just trust in the Lord. We're getting stronger and stronger so he can get home. So please keep him lifted up in prayer. Brother David Harrison that I mentioned. And then praying for Miss Judy Beatty down at the village at Allendale. And then praying for Miss Frances Lawson as well. And then leadership in our nation, and then also leadership locally, our Washington County Mayor and our County Commissioner. And then on the right side, praying for some of our missionaries, the Joneses, faithful missionaries in Russia, and then the Bushes as they help with Vision Baptist Missions. And then Joe and Melissa Marshall, we've been having a wonderful time just getting to know them a little bit more as we've helped them with some projects as of late. So keep them lifted up in prayer. And then Miss Summer Scrawls getting close, close, close. We had a wonderful commissioning service here the other night, but she's getting very close to departure. So keep her lifted up in prayer these last few meetings, and then all the things that come together about containers and all of that. So please pray, and then pray for Maddie Brown as well as she's out and about on Deputation Trail. Pray the Lord will keep her safe and bless her. And then you'll see the video down there listed. We'll play that at the end just without live stream. And so from our missionary over there, just for safety is what they've requested. And so we'll certainly keep them lifted up in prayer. And then praying for our 9th and 10th grade boys, Richard Ball, as we're praying for him and the loss of his dad. But he helps down that department, as does Scotty Carrier. Praying for Brother Daniel Wakefield as he works with our music and all that he does. And then the Magnuses as they take care of so many things around here. Praying for Brother Ron Smith and Nola as our Deacon of the Week. And then praying for bus number 12, Brother John Potter and Marty Scroggs and Mercy Elijah Gallion and Trista Reed and Evan Wilcox. And so we certainly ask the Lord to bless our bus ministry. Then praying for Brent and Matthew as they continue to serve our country and our Savior. And so there's some upcoming events. We want to pray over those. But those are just some of the things I want you to be in prayer about. Let me make sure I don't have any others on this one that I want you to keep up to date on. No, I think that's it. Continue to pray for the Mullinses, of course, over in England. Brittany would have flown back at the beginning of this week. And so pray that she gets settled back in with her family and all. So we've got many folks there to pray for. Maybe you've got an unspoken. Like to signify by uplifted hand, something on your heart. I've got something I'd like for you to pray about, and unspoken as well. And so let's pray one for another about that. And what we do is just open it up. It's an old-fashioned prayer meeting, and I want you to just go to the Lord on behalf of these folks that need our help and need our prayer help. And so I'm going to ask the organist just to play something softly through, and as they play, let's pray together, and then just a little bit I'll come back up and close us, and then we'll have Brother Nathan come and lead us in a song. And Father, we do thank you for the chance to pray, and we ask for these requests, dear Lord, that you would move. We understand, dear Lord, our minds are so finite, and we can only see just a little bit that we've got vision of, but we pray and ask you to work, and dear Lord, in all of these things, though, we pray that your will be done, and Lord, according to thy will, may they be answered, we pray. And I ask you to bless and meet with us in this service, and we'll certainly thank you for all that you give us, and dear Lord, it's just a joy to be with you, yes, and then even on top of that, dear Lord, just we get to fellowship with other people who love you as well. Thank you for letting us be here tonight. Pray that you bless us in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, Brother Nathan's going to come and lead us in, oh, how I love Jesus. I appreciate him. He came from work leading for us. Daniel went over to discipleship to go through some Bible truths with some folks. And Brother Nathan's going to come and lead us in 627. If you're able to stand together, there is a name I love to hear. I love to sing its worth. Let's sing it, but think about it as we sing it as well. It does sound like music in mine ear, the sweetest name on earth.
Sing it from your heart. Oh, how I love Jesus. There is a name I love to hear, I love to sing His word. It sounds like music in my ear, the sweetest name on earth. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus.
The Lord. Well, Brother Joe Shaw is going to ask God's blessings on the offering. I'm so thankful for the way the Lord takes care of us. But Brother Joe, would you pray and ask God's blessings?
Lord, thank you so much for this time tonight and Lord, for opportunity to give back, Lord, what you've given for us. Thank you how you just bountifully blessed all of us here, Lord, and how you blessed our church as well. May you continue to provide the needs of the church and to provide needs for the missionaries. And just thank you for how you've continued to use our pastor to lead us in the direction we need to go. And bless this offering, we pray now in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. You may be seated.
Lord Jesus, how he's loved us. Let's sing this last song that I love to tell the story. Telling people about Jesus is what we're called to do. Let's sing it out. You may remain seated on this last song. I love to tell the story.
I love to tell the story of us.
you to look back one more time, Nathan, at hymn number 627. We sang it on the first, in the middle there, fellows. Oh, how I love Jesus. I just thought we'd sing that again. And sometimes I know that we sing stuff and we're not even thinking about what we sing, or I do anyways. But that first verse that we'll sing in the chorus, there is a name I love to hear. I love to sing its worth. And I'm afraid that too many times singing is just like we do the rest of our Christian life. We just kind of rush on through it and we get it done, mark the check box and say, okay, I did that. But let's sing that first verse in the chorus. Oh, how I love Jesus. It truly is the sweetest name on earth. Nathan, lead us in that first one, would you please? Love of Jesus Christ. Well, a couple of announcements I forgot to mention. There's some of these forms out there in the lobby there on the black table as well. There's a VBS volunteer interest form. If you'd like to help us with Vacation Bible School, we certainly would love to have you. And so there's a place you can sign up for the areas of interest and then shirt size and all those things. And so we're going to have a great time together. We'd love for you to be a part of all of that for our Vacation Bible School. We ask you to get those filled out and you can drop them by. You can drop them in the offering plate. You can give them to an usher, give them to one of the staff, whichever, but just get those in if you don't mind. We'll look back in Colossians if you would, and as again, we'll stop a little early tonight, and then we'll watch a video from one of our missionaries in a restricted area, restricted nation, but we're looking at Colossians chapter 4. We're looking at verse number 5 and 6, and I decided to take just these two couple of verses for tonight. We'll look on at the next three probably next week, but we're looking at verse number 5, Colossians 4, and verse number 6. The Bible tells us to do this. We're told to walk in wisdom. It says, walk in wisdom toward them that are without, redeeming the time. Let your speech be always with grace, seasoned with salt, that you may know how you ought to answer every man. And you say, Pastor, those are such simple verses. Well, let me ask you this. How good are you doing at the end of verse number 6? And before you say, oh, those are simple verses, I don't even understand how we're taking any time studying those. Tell me how you tell me, you confess your sins to me, I won't confess them to you. How's that? Tell me how you're doing at the end of verse number 6, and then we'll see how much we need it. Because we're not ready, or we don't always know how we ought to answer every man. And maybe I can rephrase it, we know how we ought to answer them. I always say that I know the answer to give. Usually it's just about 3 to 5 minutes after I gave the wrong answer. Because when you're in a situation and somebody gets you fired up and then you just rapid fire back on some things that you shouldn't have ever said, and then 5 minutes later you think, oh, I should have said this. And may we get some help from the Lord tonight. Father, bless us now is our prayer. Give us your help, dear Lord. Thank you for the chance to be here. Dear Lord, I'm so excited. I see the sun shining through, and it'll still be shining when we get out of here. I'm excited for the good weather, and I'm excited to see these folks. And Lord, I'm blessed to be their pastor. I'm thankful that we're in church together. And now, Lord, we get to open up your word. I pray that we would open up our hearts just like we opened up the pages of this book, and we would let it in. In Jesus' name, amen. So we're told to walk in wisdom of the Lord. And so as we walk in this wisdom of the Lord, it's supposed to spill out to everybody that we happen to be around. So basically, this is a little course on how you're supposed to live around the people who you work with, live with, vacation with, and you see and you rub shoulders with. Walk in wisdom. Now we walk in wisdom toward them that are without, those people who we have contact. So let's look first of all at the verse number 5 as it tells us to walk in wisdom. We are supposed to walk in wisdom because people are truly looking at you of how you live your life as a Christian. They may not know that you go to an independent Baptist church. They may not know that you carry that King James Bible. They may not know that you come even on a Wednesday night. They don't know all that stuff, but they know there's something weird about you, and they're not exactly sure how to put their finger on it, but they know something. Well, when they know that, then we're responsible. Well, if they don't know that, but we're responsible to live a certain way in front of those people. You know, you don't get any days off. Not as a Christian. You don't get to say, well, Lord, I'm going to check out for now. Now I'm going to go treat everybody bad at every store I go to. I'm going to speak my mind to everybody that says or that says anything to me. Like the one lady told her husband, don't give them a piece of your mind. You don't have much left. You don't get a day off. Say, I'm going to speak my mind to everybody I come in contact with. When they tell me ask me what I think, I'm just going to really tell them. We don't get a day off. We're Christians all the time. Supposed to be. And we're testimonies all the time. We may be poor ones sometimes, but we're testimonies. And so the Bible says we're supposed to walk in wisdom, and this is who we're supposed to walk in wisdom before, toward them that are without. You could come in here, and you could have come in, and maybe you did. You came in tonight, and you're just mad because something happened that you didn't like. You left work in a huff, and it wasn't going like you want to. You finally just closed it all down, and you said, forget it. I'm just going to mess with it later. And you came in mad, and you were upset, and you're talking to people, and people, how you doing? And then you come around and say, hey, it's a great night, isn't it? Maybe for you. And you know, every person, you're smarting them off. Well, probably, I can't guarantee this, but probably we'll give you a break. Now, we'll talk about you to everybody, but we'll give you a break. Because we're Christians. We know that you're just having a bad day, and I know that Christians have a bad day. You say, how do you know Christians have a bad day? Because I is one of them, and I know I have bad days. So I'm going to give you a pass sometimes. But can I tell you who won't give you a pass? That unsaved person that you have as a coworker that know you're one of those churchy people. I thought church people didn't do that kind of stuff. I didn't think they talked like that. I didn't think they acted like that. I didn't think they did this. And what you'd like to say is, us churchy people, we've got more problems than you people unchurchy people. You folks, you get to do whatever you want to do. And we've got this Holy Spirit that restrains us and convicts us. And so we're walking. We might give you that pass as you came in and you're grumpy and ugly and speaking ill to everybody. We say, well, he's just having a bad day. Don't just ignore him. But at work or at school or wherever it is, when we're around those unsaved people, those that are without, I got to do better than that. Walk in wisdom toward them that are without. So we're supposed to walk in wisdom. There's many things that we do as Christians that many things we do that don't give the Lord a good name. People will even use their faith as a way to be frivolous, or they'll use their faith, I should say, as a way to be foolish, I should say, not frivolous, but foolish. Things like this, people will say, well, God led me not to take treatments for that certain illness. Now, God may lead you not to take treatments for that illness, but you have to be in the right atmosphere to share those things, because sometimes you can seem foolish to a world that's just looking for something to call you a strange person over. So it very well could be, you may be sitting in this room, and probably there are with a crowd this size, that the Lord led you not to address something. And that was between you and the Lord, and you felt confident that wasn't what the Lord's will. And I'm saying, follow God in all of those things. But what I do think is unwise is when you announce it to all the unsaved people, you say, well, I'm not going to do any of that because God's going to save me. God may just let you go to heaven with that thing. And that's why I'm talking just a small illustration of how we ought to walk in wisdom to those that are without. I knew a fella that he quit his job, and he said God wanted him just to go on by faith. He was just going to go try to knock on doors in all that area, tell people about the Lord, which is a wonderful thing. But the only problem was it wasn't too many weeks or months after that they had to go back and get another job because it didn't pan out like he thought it would. And you know what we do when that happens? We give the devil a little inroad into the lives of those people who are scrutinizing what we do. And you say, Pastor, it sounds like there's no discharge from this war. Sounds like there's no off-duty time. And really, that's about the truth. And so I'm telling us, folks, we ought to walk in wisdom toward those that are without. The Bible says, and wisdom, we understand, comes from above. In James chapter 1, it says, let him ask of God that giveth to all men liberally, and he upbraideth not. So who are we walking toward? We're walking toward those people that are without. We're walking in front of those people. We are standing. We're living our lives so that the people that are around us can look and see the Lord working our lives. You know the saying that we are the only Bible that some people will ever read. And that's so true. They won't pick up the Word of God. They'll just go ahead and look at you and say, oh, I don't want that responsibility because I don't want them to look at me. I'm not always on, and I'm not either. I may not want that responsibility, but I got it, as do you. And so we see that wisdom comes from the Lord. Let him ask of God. Wisdom, our wisdom is on display to those around us. That's why we got to be careful to walk with the Lord so that we can get the wisdom we need. And then we can be those folks, those testimonies that God wants us to be. So we see we're supposed to walk in wisdom. At the end of that verse, it tells us this, redeeming the time. Look back, if you will, at Ephesians. So hold your place in Colossians. You'll see in Ephesians, as God used Paul to write to this church as well, that he told him nearly the same thing. In Ephesians chapter 5, verse number 16, we see in our passage there, just it says redeeming the time. But in Ephesians chapter 5, verse number 16, he tells us redeeming the time because the days are evil. It's almost as if the more evil the days are, the more you've got to buy back that time, because that's exactly what that word redeem means. It just means to buy it back. We need to make good use of the time that God has given us. And most of the people in this room aren't 20. And you're understanding that many of you, you have less time left than you've already spent. And so there's some things that you want to do. You've got, in the world, they would call that a bucket list, which sounds like a great thing until you realize what it means before I kick the bucket. Be nice to say I've got a mattress list, something I want to give before I lay down that mattress or something. But the bucket list, there's some of you want to do some certain things. Well, there ought to also be some spiritual things that we want to do on our bucket list. Some family members that I'm praying desperately for that they'll get right with God. Some family members that I'm praying desperately for they'll come back to Christ. There are some family members that I'm praying that they understand how valuable their life is before God. We need those spiritual bucket lists as well. Why do we get fervent about that? Because we're redeeming the time. There's not much of it left. So we're supposed to redeem the time. We need to make good use of what time God has given us. Why? Well, because there's a short, finite little amount of it. But then because also the days are evil out here and about. The fire's getting hot, and we've got to get busy for the Lord. We got a certificate not real long time ago to the Riverfront Seafood. Somebody gave it to us, but it had an expiration date on it. And so I don't want to let anything go to waste. If it's free, I want to take it. So I had every intention of going, but Amy and I were going somewhere. I can't remember if it was BIMI or somewhere. And so we were going to be gone, and we were leaving, and the next day it expired. I thought, oh, what a tragedy to let, however many, $25, $35, $40, I don't know what it was, but something. So I told the girls, I said, all right, you know where that is? No. Well, you're going to find out where it is because it's up there in Kingsport. So go up there and make sure we use this $35 certificate because we're not going to let it go dead. You say, what would that have hurt? Well, it hurt our pride, that's for sure. You know, you had that free thing going and nobody got to use it. And so we sent the girls up there. We were off somewhere and they used it, all of it. They use that, and their girls are good at spending money. They spent that plus some. So it all worked out fine, just like you'd expect them to. We redeemed it. And folks, the Lord has given us something much more valuable than just a $35, $40 certificate to a restaurant. He's given you your life. And sometimes, I'm not indicting you tonight, but you see if it works for you or not. But sometimes we're more diligent about redeeming a coupon before it expires than we are using the life that God has given us for His glory. You've only got one life, as C.T. Studd said, only one life, 'twill soon be passed. Only what's done for Christ will last. Redeeming the time because the days are evil. the days are evil, our time is evil, our world is evil. And I'd just like to ask you this before I move on to the next point. What have you done in this evil day in which we live? What have you done to make Jesus look good with the people you've been around? Because that's what you're doing. When you redeem the time, you're taking the opportunity, you're giving, you're buying it back for God's glory. And so that would look like you doing something to make the Lord look good. My wife's got a twin sister, and so she said one time to Amy that her mission in that little time of her life was to cheer up the grumpy tellers and clerks and people that she ran into. Now, you know what we want to do to those grumpy tellers and clerks. We give right back to them. You know, given it shall be given unto you. We'll give it right back to you. She wanted to make it her mission to try to cheer them up. And I'm asking us, what have we done this week to give a good image to the Lord Jesus Christ? Have we redeemed any time? Have we clipped any coupons? Maybe have we given a tract to somebody, or have we shared with somebody that, hey, do you mind if I pray for you about that? You've seen somebody at the doctor's office, and you can get a good word in for the Lord in many different ways. You don't have to get your little soapbox and stand up and preach and say, let me tell you a few things from the book here. You can just ask somebody who you happen to see in the doctor's office when they're telling you about all this stuff, say, well, do you mind if I pray for you tonight? Most of them will say, oh, please do. It's just putting a word in for the Lord. So we redeem the time. We buy it back. We take those opportunities for the Lord's glory. Walk in wisdom toward those that are without and redeeming the time. Now, point number three, we've got to guard our speech. The Bible says, let your speech be always with grace, seasoned with salt. Sometimes we take out the grace part. We just say, we'll just make it salty. We'll make it rough. We'll make it kind of bitter. We'll make it untasteful to people. That's not what the Scripture says. Our speech ought to glorify God always with grace. I think about different people here. Bert works and he talks to a lot of different people. Phyllis talks to people as they come in. But I heard Bert the other day, he was talking to somebody, he was trying to get off the phone, and he was trying to do it kindly. But man, that salesman was a bulldog on the other side, just kept on. And I don't remember what he said. I know he didn't cuss. That's nice. I was listening for that, making sure. But he finally just had to get stern with him, but he was still kind in the sternness. He said, listen, I'm sorry, I just can't do that, and whatever he said. But we ought to always do what we do with grace. You got to cancel some subscription and you got to get stern with somebody even though they're not doing right. You're supposed to do it with grace. You get the umpteenth sales call about the same matter that you've already told them each time that you're not interested in. Either do it with grace or click and hang up on them and don't say anything mean. You say, that's not very kind. Well, it's kinder than what you were going to say to them. So a dial tone is better than what you could have said. How's that? But your speech ought to always glorify God. Let your speech be always. I'm not joking, folks. Sometimes we think that we want to look up the Lord. Lord, give me 5 minutes with him, and after that, I'll do the Christian thing, but just give me 5 minutes. But that's not the way it works. Always with grace. And so as we look at this, we're supposed to guard our speech. Season, the Bible says, with salt. Now, everybody knows that I spent a lot of time in the hospitals, and one of the complaints about hospitals is the food. And that's because the folks that are in food services, they really have a tough job. They're trying to prepare for people that have this restriction, that restriction, the other restriction, 14 other, and there's really no winning for them. I understand. You say, oh, they could have done better than they did. And probably maybe they could, but I'm just saying that they've got a tough job. They're not allowed to use a seasoning because what might work for you won't work for somebody else. But we use seasonings for a reason, because it brings the flavor out. It brings something pleasant to the experience. You can take something that, or somebody can, and that's something that's kind of bland, and they can take that hunk of chicken, that chicken breast, and it can be, instead of it just being dull and bland, they can use the right seasonings and prepare it all right and marinate it and do all these things and make something that is much more pleasant. And that's what the scripture says, that our speech, it ought to always be with grace all the time. And then we ought to season it, shake the salt on that speech, how we behave and how we talk toward people. We sometimes just forget. And usually what happens is, if we forget, the flesh is quick to jump in. I'm telling you, folks, this is a battle. The Lord says in His Word that we're supposed to put ye on the Lord Jesus Christ. We're supposed to suit up and be ready to let our speech be something that pleases Him. And it goes on to say at the end of the verse that ye know how ye ought to answer every man. This seasoned speech that we're supposed to have, salt, we know what it does. It brings up the flavor. It also is used as something for preservation. But that speech that's seasoned with that salt, it's got such a powerful, can have such a powerful effect in our lives. And more importantly, in the people that are around us. So that we might know how to answer every man. So when we've got every man that we have to answer to, or we've got to answer about, we've got to answer some things to them about different things in life. Every man includes some people that I rub shoulders with that are saved. Again, even though I was joking about, you come in here, you're grumpy as all get out, we'll probably give you a pass. We shouldn't have to, nor should you have to for me. So some of those every man are those people that know the Lord Jesus Christ. But many of those every man are the people you rub shoulders with and they don't know the Lord at all. And those are the ones that are really important. Because those are the ones that need to have that grace-filled talk of yours. And of course it goes much more than just your talk. It goes to your actions and your lifestyle and all of those things. But you've got to guard that speech, because that tasteful, pleasant speech that God wants us to have is how we're supposed to answer every single person that we hang out with and that we rub shoulders with. I've got to take you all the way back to the very beginning, because what our goal ultimately is, everybody that we come into contact with, we're trying to point them to the cross. And so if you or I are getting in the way of them seeing the cross because of our wrong speech, shame on us. You say, Pastor, they deserved it. You say, they had it coming. God doesn't tell us to be seasoned with salt and have grace toward every man except for those ones that really, really deserve it. Because I can remind you that you don't deserve everything you got either. In the good way. So let your speech be always that way. So where the impact of this passage is toward those that are without. And I'm afraid too much of our Christian lives have been geared toward those that are within. And I think if we get our eyes on this lost and dying world and realize that God left us in it to try to reach them for Him, then we will take more account of what we say, what we don't say, and how we say what we do say, because we're living that way toward them that are without. I'm asking you plain this evening to take a little inventory on your life. How am I behaving toward everybody, especially those that are without? Is my speech such that glorifies God? Or is my speech such that they may have to wonder, I don't even know if he is a Christian. One old preacher put it like this, if you were accused of being a Christian, would there be enough evidence to convict you? Amen. That's a pretty humbling thought. And I hope that our coworkers, our neighbors, our friends, our fellowship, or whoever we rub shoulders with, again, they may not know everything about you. They may not know that you are here on a Wednesday night. They may not know all these specifics, but they know there's something different about you. I hope that's true. And if it's not true, you don't have to go jump up on the table in the break room and say, I just want everybody to know I'm a Christian. It's not allowed in many of your workplaces, so I certainly don't advise that. But you start seasoning that speech with salt. You start letting our speech be always with grace. You start giving the Lord glory in the way you behave yourself and the way you present yourself and the way you talk. You start excusing yourself when the talk gets vulgar around the area that you can't control anyways, but you start excusing yourself when that starts happening and the message gets clear eventually. Walk in wisdom toward those that are without. And if we're going to walk in that wisdom, we got to get connected to that wise wisdom source, and that's the Lord. And can I tell you why we oftentimes have problems with being the testimony and the witness we should without? Because we're not getting that time alone with the Lord and getting our batteries recharged. So if wisdom comes from Him, walk in wisdom toward them that are without. There's only one source of that wisdom. There's lots of sources for education. There's lots of sources for knowledge, but only one source for wisdom, and that's the Lord. So if we're going to walk in wisdom toward those that are without, I've got to walk with the wise, the wisdom giver, and that's the Lord, before I go without. Father, bless us now as our prayer. Thank you for this time to be in your book. And Lord, I pray for this very simple message that it would, this lesson would just bring us closer to being what we ought to be for you. And Lord, we'll certainly thank you for it. As the ladies come and they get ready to play our invitation hymn, here's my question for you. It's hard to come to the altar on a message like that. Well, I don't want people to think I'm talking this, that, and the other. First of all, we shouldn't be worried what people think anyways. But number two, if the Lord speaks to our heart and leads us to come, then I challenge you to do it. But maybe He doesn't want you to come. He just wants you to make commitments right there in your seat. Whichever the case is, I hope that you'll do business with the Lord. I have a sneaking suspicion that all of us need to work on this speech of ours. That all of us need to be doing it all the way with grace, seasoned with salt. And I pray if the Lord has convicted you tonight that you'd word a prayer to Him, say, Lord, help me. You got me. Help me now to walk appropriately toward those that are without. And I'll thank you for it. If you're able to stand together with us as they begin to play. If God spoke to your heart, I invite you to come. The last thing I'd like to say is if you're here and you're not sure that you're saved, oh, my friend, please, would you step out? Let me take the Bible and show you how you can be sure Jesus is your Savior. I didn't preach on that, teach on that, but you certainly need to do it. Lead us in that song that she's playing, Have Thine Own Way. And I pray the Lord has His own way with you and you let Him do it.
Have Thine Own Way, Lord. Have Thine Own Way. Thou art the potter. I am the clay. Mold me and make me after Thy will. While I am waiting, you will have.
Seated. If you're certainly welcome to do that. We're going to see a video here in just